Hello everyone, welcome. On behalf of the Bahraini community, I'd like first of all to thank Al-Zahra Foundation for hosting this event, and importantly thank our speaker guests here and you all for your presence. With us today are two speakers from Bahrain. Let me take this chance to introduce them to you. First of all, on my right, Dr. Jassim Hussain, a former Member of Parliament of Al-Wifaq Islamic Party from 2006 to 2010. He's an economist and former lecturer at the University of Bahrain. Al-Wifaq, as you might know, is the main opposition party that recently resigned altogether from the parliament. And also to my left is Mr. Mohamed Matar, a political activist, former president of the Democratic Youth Society, and formerly he was a member, a central committee member at National Democratic Action Party, also known as WAAD, the second main political party, which is a secular and leftist in terms of identity. The structure would have is give Dr. Hussain a chance to speak for 20 to 25 minutes, and that's up to him, followed by Mr. Matar, then open up for discussion, questions and answers. And so we'll start with Dr. Hussain.
As you know, Bahrain has been going through different types of problems. Every now and then we had already in 1980s demands for change, also 1990s and 2000, and then in 2011. So this is things that has always been demand. Now at the moment, to the best of my knowledge or the background that I come, is that a main demand for the mainstream opposition and for most of the people is transforming the country into constitutional monarchy. That there should be a king, but at the same time we should have institutions working properly in the country. There is no one best example we have, but along like a combination of what is in place in Malaysia and some European countries, something that would fit the region. So the idea is to have something that could, that must take into account the regional place of the country. So really, the nature of the system is at the moment the king is like the absolute ruler, not very much confined by constitution or so. So we want to have make sure that there is a monarchy, but a constitution, not just any kind of monarchy. That's one demand. Another demand has to do with really having a parliament with full authorities. Authorities with regards to making legislations and at the same time monitoring governmental activities and all the bodies in the country. Really, now really what we have in Bahrain is a bicameral. Really. We have two chambers, an elected one and an appointed one. Each one consists of 40 members. Draft laws start with the elected, but end with the appointed. Appointed can always block things, appointed, but still they have equal somehow equal powers as the elected. This is not working properly. So now the demand is really to have maybe a parliament with no appointed sure council, just the elected body, and being able to to make laws and amend things. I myself was a member of parliament for the last 5 years, really. We tried very hard to bring about change, but we could only do so much. People were giving us credit for trying, but not for achieving. We could not achieve so much, and we could not take credit for it. So this is really We also say that any government in Bahrain now should partly reflect results of elections. And hence the parliamentary setup, because at the moment there is nothing. So that really has to take into account. So that's the number two. Number three is, the electoral districts really must be fair, not what we have now. In 2010, my society, Al-Wifaq, we won 18 out of 40 seats. That's 45% of the seats. But in terms of popular votes, we got 63 of the popular votes. 63, but we only got 45. Why? Because of gerrymandering of districts. Some districts are fairly large. The Shia districts are large. Others are fairly small. So we don't have the universal practice of one person, one vote. Votes in some areas have more weight than others. So that's really... So we had the case, the majority in 2010 elected the minority. Which is certainly not acceptable, you know. Certainly we cannot have 100% equal department, equal districts. But reasonable, minus plus five. Not such a rate. For example, now we have one MP for one province. His district equals all districts in one governorate. So one compared to five. His name is Matar. And very sadly that he's now behind bars. He's now really in jail. We think really possibly, or at least partly for expressing his views to international media over the last few months. So really a guy will be now really the most elected as such, really, because he got more votes than anybody else. So we really have the other demand really the opposition wants is we must do away with all kind of sectarian and tribal and ethnic practices, really. Because at the moment we have like that. But the country is divided so much along sectarian lines, you know, or family lines. This from this tribe, so they should take some jobs, you know. Generally, there is discrimination against Shia. Shia really are the minority in the government. Like out of 21 cabinet posts, there are only three Shia ministers. They are the minority amongst ambassadors and you name it. And certainly, we've always been telling the government, really, I say that from the economic point of view, that discrimination is denying Bahrain a competitive advantage. Others are benefiting at the expense of Bahrain. Dubai is benefiting at the expense of Bahrain, Qatar is benefiting at the expense of Bahrain. You know. So discrimination is causing disallocation of scarce resources. It's a problem for us. So we want this to end. This cannot really go on. The other thing the opposition wants now is we should have really an impartial judiciary system. Because now at the moment there is so much interference, you know, from the part of the authorities. You know, they dictate how the verdict should go. You know, we had on 22nd of June the military tribunal issued, you know, extraordinary verdicts against some people. You know, so you have some of these really, you know, good people in Bahrain. Many of them really were given life sentence for expressing their views. You know, so the verdicts were told. There was no real, really, you know, judicial practices or, you know, due diligence and stuff like that. So this really, again, most of the judges really go along tribal lines. This family, that tribe. Certainly they tend to be, you know, loyal to the authorities rather than the people, for sure. Yet another demand has to do with really doing away with financial corruption in the country. There's so much financial and administrative corruption in the country. Bahrain is small, really, but because of that you find land prices are very high. There's just, again, like some influential people, they put their hands on some big areas of the country. Piece of land, and then they divide the land and sell to plots to other. We have some people who have now ownership of part of the sea, but somebody owns part of the sea. Just talking about the level of the other thing really, the demand number eight is to make sure that we really have a free press. We have a free press and free civil society. Lots of restrictions on them now. We had a newspaper called Al Wasat, which was relatively free, known for really taking sides of the people, really. But really, had to go really through hardship recently. The authorities put pressure on the paper. It's not functioning normally now. They changed the editor, and many things are changing. Now, having said that, I must make it very clear that the mainstream opposition in Bahrain is not demanding change of the regime. They are demanding changes within. Not of the regime. We think the idea of change of the regime is not viable, is not possible, is something beyond the means of the people. It could really derail the country and into some really bloodshed and problems. and that the country could become much like Somalia or more like Yemen, or that is something about. So that's really about. That's really what's really missing. That we need to have maybe about changes within, but we need a country with institutions, with a system in place, with a portfolio power parliament. Now, other points I want to mention very quickly here, that you know what's really happening in Bahrain is not because of Iran or because of Iraq, or that's not really the case. The authorities try to say, well, no, there's the Shia connection. You know, but in fact, I had, you know, while visiting here in the UK, I talked to some of the officials really, and they said very clearly that they could see, they could not trace any Iranian hands in the developments of Bahrain. I've taken over the last few months. But Iran was not behind what happened in Bahrain in mid-February. Okay. Later on, Iran entered into media, really attack of the pressure on Bahrain. That is something else. It was not because of Iraq. The Shias in Iraq were not the ones who really told Bahrainis. Yes, there was then, you know, sympathy from some of them, you know, some of these TV stations in Iraq, but it was not because of either Iran or Iraq, you know, as such. Now, anyway, as you said, the government then, you know, made the decision of bringing Saudi troops, and the Saudi troops really made things much worse. You know, there was a political problem in Bahrain, but Saudi troops came in, you know, in charge of that. They want to deter really any possible Iranian threat, or as they say, external threat. There was no external threat. It was a problem, but local. Now, entry of Saudi troops have only made things worse. In fact, I was saying that we have a local problem, but not a local solution. The solution now must satisfy Saudi, must satisfy the US, UK, Iran, and others. While it was a local problem, not a security problem, political problem. People demanding change. Now, I must also say really I think there were, since speaking of the people, I think there were some mistakes also. You know, let me just go to the second part of my talk. Mistakes happened during what happened in Bahrain. Really, some of the slogans were possibly wrong that have been made. You know, the slogan of "People demand downfall of the regime" was a very dangerous statement. Like we're saying that we should demand streamlining, improvement rather than downfall. Downfall was very dangerous. We told authorities very clearly that people are just saying, they don't mean what they say. But it was an opportunity for some. They say, well, we take you by your intention. إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّةِ. Your niya is downfall. You cannot do it now because you don't have the means, but you have the intention. So we judge you by your intention. Very dangerous statement, really. Unfortunately, this statement was imported from Tunisia, Egypt, you know, became famous thanks to Arab Spring. It is not realistic. No. Now, other things really I must say, there were also some other mistakes during the uprising in Bahrain. We had some people really, the activities were centered in the roundabout, or the Pearl roundabout, in the heart of Manama. But we had some people who went like to the financial harbor, the financial district. They took control of the entry of the district. That also gave opportunity to authorities to say that, you see, these people have design. They are not having any political. Why do they want to take control of a financial district? Blocking of some roads, major highways, some people blocked highways, so that people could not really commute back and forth from their jobs. Really, again, a mistake. There was no need, there was also an offer what was made by the Crown Prince for a dialogue, but the opposition could not close ranks and enter into that dialogue openly. The feelings were very high, you know, and say no dialogue whatsoever, really. It was an opportunity, but certainly a missed opportunity, you know, as such. At the time, the offer was relatively good. The Crown Prince was talking about a fully empowered parliament, redistribution of the financial districts, really, fighting administrative corruption, stuff like that, some good stuff. But, you know, we had some people who thought, no. Change of regime, nothing short of that, certainly not a realistic goal. In the context of Bahrain, so when you say Bahrain, you're also talking about Saudi, you're talking about some regional things. It's certainly it's not a local problem as such. It is much more than that. Now, as to the really mistakes by the regime, really, use of violence. It was a terrible mistake by them. Really. There was no need for using, in fact, anybody getting killed or injured. Really. This was not a security, but it was a political problem. There was a need for a political solution. So authorities used really live ammunition in some cases. We had 4 people who died in prison while in custody. So they were at the control of the authorities. There was no point for them getting killed. In fact, 2 of them were non-publishers. One of them, the last person, to be killed, released him, Abdul Karim Fukhrawi. He himself handed himself in. The authorities said, there's a problem. Somebody has come to his house and told him, this is me. And he wants to speak to me. And after 9 days, he was killed while in jail. The other thing really is bringing Saudi troops. Terrible mistake really by the authorities. Seems like the Saudis were really very much looking into their own potential spillover into Eastern Saudi Arabia. By sending Saudi troops, they were sending a message that you see that we're going to Bahrain, at the same time, you Shia and Saudi, be careful. This is how we are dealing with an external, let alone an internal. Another mistake by the authorities of really going into undermining ties with the Shia at large, saying bad things about Lebanon, about Hezbollah, and bad things about Iraq, bad things about Iran. Too much for a small country like Bahrain. In fact, Bahrain even went on publicly to demand that this year's originally planned Arab summit in Baghdad to be suspended. They said, we don't want to be in Iraq. And Bahrain said that. Bahrain is a small country saying something like that to a big country like Iraq. Laying off people, terrible mistake, laying off hundreds of Shias, really, and expelling hundreds of others from schools, causing hardship. Bahrain TV really promoting hate message. First time official TV really saying bad things openly about people, by names, going into private lives of people, just because of revenge and stuff like that. So, generally speaking, like I said, really, what I can really just, saying in short, really, so demands in Bahrain, really, for political purposes. This was not the first time, possibly this was the most extraordinary. For the first time we had something like that, nationwide, or at least large number of people were in the streets. But at the same time, I say there were mistakes made by the opposition, but also mistakes made by the government. Now certainly the solution, if any, looks very difficult. It's very hard to find a solution that requires concession from both parties. It's not easy. It's not easy for the opposition to say, well, okay, forget it, fine. It's also not easy for the authorities to say, forget it. They have the mind, they think, there was a design against them from the Shia in Bahrain, with coordination by Shia elsewhere, really. So very complicated. Now, very complicated. I don't see really any exit, very, very hard to see an exit strategy now for Bahrain. Inshallah. But definitely, the need is for compromise from all parties. I'll stop at this point. I'm sure we can talk a lot during the Q&A. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Hussein. And let me just sum up what Dr. Hussein went through. So basically, he spoke about the demands for change from the majority of people, the mainstream of opposition. He talked about the need of transformation to the constitutional monarchy, which people voted on in 2001, a parliament of full authorities. And he went on talking about the problems with the appointed chamber, which is hampering any sort of change, which might be highlighted by the elected chamber. One person, one vote system, sectarian/tribal system, which is making this all a bigger problem. Generally, discrimination against Shias, interference in the judiciary system, loyalty to the regime, and some people were closer in terms of privileges, etc. Financial and administrative corruption, and the demand for free press give an example of Al-Wasat newspaper, which was suspended for some time, and he then went on speaking about the mistakes from both sides, the people and the regime. First of all, some chants were irrelevant, in his opinion, to Bahrain. The activities which were in the center of Manama went through to the financial harbor, and to Dr. Hussein, this was a bigger step which shouldn't have happened. Not getting engaged fully with the Crown Prince offer of dialogue initially, that was a missed opportunity, which was relatively good in terms of offer. And on the other hand, the regime mistakes were use of violence, inviting Saudi troops, undermining ties with Shia all over the world, especially Lebanon, Iraq and Iran, laying off hundreds of people, expelling students and spreading hatred messages across Bahrain TV. And he thinks overall there is a hard solution and it's hard to see an exit, but hopefully things will change. There is a local problem, but a regional solution that should come from outside Bahrain, satisfying Bahrain, Saudi Arabia, US, and other places. Let me now give the mic to Mr. Matar, and he will have 15 to 20 minutes to give his opinion.
Thank you, Sayyid Ali, and thank you everybody who are gathering today as an interest to give a support to the uprising in Bahrain. I'm not going to add points to what Mr. Jassim Hussein said. He mentioned most of the situation there in Bahrain. I'm just going to read the scene and analyze it in another view. As he said, and we approve it, that it is a constitutional political crisis in Bahrain. It is not economical, let's say, situation. Economical situation is a fact, but not a factor within the crisis. Many uprisings, and we say this is an uprising, it is not a revolution, because politically when we say a revolution, so it is a movement that had already gained power and done some changes which did not happen yet in Bahrain. So it is an uprising. Hopefully it could be in the future a succeeded revolution. So many uprisings occurred in Bahrain recently in the last decades. Every 10 to 15 years we are facing an uprising in Bahrain. This uprising especially started in 14th of Feb. People gathered and went to streets for one demand. I'm reading the main slogan, people demands to overthrow the regime, which is in Arabic, الشعب يريد إسقاط النظام. And Nizam in Arabic, when we translate it to English, it is not only the regime, it is the system. And Nizam in Arabic is the system. So in each country, the system is how are the authorities granted, how are the, it is splitted and shared. So in each country in the world, the system is constituted, instituted in a constitution. There is a problem in the constitution of 2002. This is a separate story. I will just go through it in a very fast way, that we had a contractual constitution that was obstructed in 1973. It was part of the it was there was an assembly elected halfly and appointed the other half, and they issued that constitution. 2 years later, 1975, Emir in that year, he just dissolved the parliament and stopped and freeze the constitution. So we waited till 2001, till the current king Hamad bin Isa, he just came up with his as called the project of reform, and it was under the name of National Charter, which people signed a referendum to support that charter in a percent of 98.4. So we signed that on that charter just to regain the constitutional, let's say, state. The king, he promised that we are going to be a constitutional monarchy. That was in 2001. And then, after 1 year later, after signing that referendum, on 14th of Feb 2001, and it was a spring during 1 year from 2001 till 2002, it was a spring of a freedom, spring of how to people, they could express their ideas, their political views, till 14th of Feb 2002, when the king announced a new constitution from one part, from his part. It is called the document of 2002, or constitution of 2002, which was totally different than the older constitution. So the story begins here, to 14th of Feb 2002, when people, they felt that they were fooled, that this is not the constitution that we sacrificed for. This was not the constitution that we demanded tens of years. So everything were accumulating till 14th of Feb 2011. I tried to shorten this story. So 14th of Feb 2011, people, especially the youth, they were depressed because of the performance of the regime, which did not, let's say, satisfy the needs of the people. They were depressed of the mechanisms of the opposition parties, especially who participated in the parliamentary elections. As Dr. Jassim Hussain, he said, people, they come, they've seen there were no outputs, even though there were some performance, but there were no outputs, nothing to feel. That's why people, they thought there should be a way to drop and cancel that constitution. Why especially constitution of 2002? Because that constitution institutes Bahrain as absolute monarchy, where the king has most of the privileges and authorities. He appoints all of the cabinet, he appoints the legislative authority, he appoints the judiciary, the half of the legislative, and the other half are elected. Even though there are half who are elected, which Dr. Jassim was part of, they don't have authorities even to account the ministers and account the prime minister himself. So lots of privileges. People demanded to overthrow when they said Iskat al-Nizam, the system which is instituted and constituted by Constitution of 2002, they wanted to cancel that constitution and start a new constitution, a new contractual constitution, to reshare the power, to reshare wealth, to reshare privileges, even symbolism. This is the main aim of the uprising. It started mainly by a spark. 14th of there were only hundreds of people who were protesting and demonstrating in their villages. Not that much, not that big number. But what happened that one of the martyrs who received the bullets of the security forces, he was the spark that people just thought that this regime or this royal family don't even give people the chance to express their demands, even though it was peaceful demonstrations. All the demonstrations were peaceful, were demanding a positive change. I'm not going to go through the details of the uprising. I'm going to talk also about the consequences of the attack after the, let's say, the Saudi troops entered Bahrain and participated beside the military of Bahrain and also the other police forces in Bahrain. As Dr. said, and I'm not going to add, but read it in another way. Most of the families now, they have either a detained person, one or more who are expelled from their universities, dismissed from their jobs, martyrs, injured people. So most of the families are suffering from the attack of the regime. The royal family, which should be a part of any, let's say, coming solution or any coming compromise, are keeping themselves away from the scene. They are trying to keep the scene as and frame it as sectarian struggle, not a national legislative demands. They are trying to keep this as sectarian by influencing some of the leaders among some sects to conflict with the other sects. Even they started a dialogue, they call it a national dialogue. They are trying to gather people by their sects, by their just to discuss even things that are not related to the situation and to show the world that, see, people are discussing their problems. We are aware of it. We think this is not the solution. The solution is to have a real, let's say, negotiation, not a dialogue. A real negotiation between the opposition parties or the oppositions. From one part with another part, the royal family. We can't say this is a national dialogue where most of the political leaders and figures are in the present. Lots of people, they are still out of their jobs. We can't say this is a national dialogue and this will solve the problem, where it is restricted to limited, let's say, points to discuss. Lots of major points are not allowed to be discussed in the dialogue, such as the naturalization, discrimination, even the constitution itself is not allowed to be discussed in the dialogue. The major opposition parties are demanding an elected government. It is not one of the points within the dialogue. So we are still optimistic about the situation. It's going to be solved, but not in the short term. We are optimistic within the long term, because still the regime feels that it's still in power, can influence people, still can gather people to be loyal to the regime. They are trying to keep the things calming down, to get to arrest, but not to a fair settlement. I'm going to stop here, and I wish we could discuss more within the questions.
Thank you, Mohammed. So, just to sum up, Mr. Matar just went through his opinion about the Bahraini uprising being an uprising rather than a revolution, and he thought it hopefully would become a revolution, but it hasn't yet reached that stage. In the past few decades, Bahrain saw many uprisings, but this time people demanded one thing. And he went on the 1973 constitution, which was a legitimate one, but then suspended after 2 years. People lived in a state of emergency until 2001, when the king who succeeded into power presented this National Action Charter, and people saw 1 year of reform and openness, and then they were shocked at the date of 14th of February 2002, when they saw a one-sided constitution giving the king an absolute powers of appointing people and giving the Supreme Chamber more power than the elected chamber. So people were devoid of any potential hope of change and reform later on. So people want the share of power, wealth, symbolism, which was restricted and confined mainly to the royal family. The uprising started with hundreds. The spark was with the heroic guy facing the bullets. And after that, all the people were inspired to go out on the streets and demand one national thing. So the consequences of the attack of the Saudi troops, bringing the Saudi troops, gave a regional picture to the problem. Nowadays, each family has a grievance of some sort, either a student being expelled, or a detainee in prison, or a martyr. The royal family has distanced themselves from people and from any potential solution. They put sectarian flavor to any dialogue or real demand. The current national dialogue is so dilute that they invited so many people to discuss so many irrelevant things to this uprising. So we are not optimistic about any change from this national dialogue. Many figures are still behind bars. Many issues such as discrimination, naturalization, and the current constitution and an elected government are not meant to be part of this national dialogue. So it's a long-term struggle, and people want to see this the way out of it, but it doesn't look very promising. So I'll take this opportunity to open up to the floor, and if anyone else wants to ask any question, please welcome. Introducing your name and to whom you want to ask your question.